morning, let's worship together the Lord Jesus Christ, who is King of all kings and Lord of all lords. As you stand and sing, worthy of worship, as we center our mind's attention and our heart's affection solely upon the Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you so much for this beautiful weather and for the Preds game tomorrow. I ask that you would just be with us in this next hour of worship and that it would be a time of peace and rest for us, that we would be opening our listening ears and that our spirits would be receptive to the word that we'll receive today, Lord. I just ask for meaningful connection, for deeper comprehension, and that we'd walk away impacted by whatever we learn today. But I say a special prayer over Kandahar and Kabul, Afghanistan, and Manchester and London, England, Lord. I just ask for both peace and healing in those spaces, Lord, in light of recent terrorist attacks. But I ask that You just help us be mindful of you and the work that you're doing all across the world with your people and with people who are so lost. I just ask that you'd be with us and you'd guide us and watch over us in this week. In the name of the Son, amen. I'm so happy to see you all. As I said, I'm Shauna and I'm your children's ministry intern this summer, and we are getting pumped for BBS, which starts just next week. So I hope that you'd keep that in your prayers. If this is your first day with us, I ask that you look at your order of worship or your bulletin and just check out that Connect card. We're gonna request that you would give us some of your contact information so that we can be in contact with you. But whether it's your first, your fifth, or your 59th trip, I ask that you look at that card and that you would write down any prayer requests that you have. We desire to be meaningfully connected with you, and we would love to be praying for you, whether it's a wedding or an injury or, I don't know, you have a dinner party that you're planning. We want to be praying for you and doing life with you. We are so excited that you are here, and I hope that this next hour of worship is great and amazing for you. I will be reading out of Psalm 86:15. But you, Lord, are compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in faithful love and truth. May you go this week knowing that God is with you and that he cares deeply for you. Thank you.
As we continue to worship, let's sing together, Like a River Glorious, finding as God promised, perfect peace and rest.
Thank you. here this morning, I wonder how many of you enjoy reading? And do any of you enjoy reading a good mystery? Do you enjoy reading a good mystery? Yeah, yeah. Who knows in the book what's going to happen next? You know, there's all kinds of twists and turns, but who knows how it's going to end? Who knows how it's going to end, the book? What do you think? Maybe if you've read it before, do you know how it's going to end? Yeah? So, also maybe the author of the book, the person that wrote the book, the author. I'm having a hard time speaking this morning. The author of the book, right, knows the ups and downs, the conflicts, what character does what, and how it ends, how it's solved, right? Well, in our lives, did you know that we're part of a story, God's story? And who knows how it's going to end? The author, right? God has written your story. Psalms 139 tells us that he has already written your story. He knows the ups and the downs, the twists and turns, the conflicts, and he knows how it's even going to end. And then there's those that have gone before, those that have read the book, their story with God. And we can learn from them, can't we? Today we start a new sermon series on Hebrews 11. Does anyone know what Hebrews 11 is called? The faith chapter. Exactly. And in Hebrews 11, it encourages us to have faith, to trust God, that he knows what is best for us, and that he knows the next step in our lives. And if it's some big mystery, we can trust him. That the God who created the universe sees us and loves us, and he is walking with us. And then Hebrews 11 goes on to tell about all these men and women who have gone before, who walked by faith, who trusted God even in really hard times. They stepped and they were obedient. And I hope that you're encouraged by their story as well. Because their story's been in the end. You know where they are? You're in heaven with Jesus. And that is my prayer for you as well, that that's where your story will end, with me in heaven with Jesus. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for the stories that you're writing in these children's lives, God. Thank you that you are big and that you are gracious. And in this stinky world sometimes when hard things happen, that you have a plan and a purpose, and we can trust the end of the story with you. God, thank you for sending your son Jesus to be the hero of our stories. And it's in his name I pray. Amen. I love you very much. You may go back to your seats.
No matter what may come our way in life or what darts Satan may hurl our way, we know that we can trust God in all things, for our God must prevail. He is the King of all kings, and he is one who, with whom we can place our faith and our trust. Have faith in God. Oh, have faith in God. Would you stand with me as we sing this great song?
Thank you. congregation, before we pray, you've just said, have faith in God. He must prevail. Do you believe it?
Amen.
Amen. We really, really do. No matter how dark or light it looks, God is with us, and He will prevail. And so in these moments of prayer, we remember especially the names and the families that I will share with you now. And then we remember someone perhaps to our left or right, in front of us or behind us, undergoing a dark moment, a difficult time, and we lift one another up to God. We remember Shirley Murphy and her family and the loss of husband Howard Murphy this week. The memorial service will be held here tomorrow at 12 o'clock noon. We remember Mona Beard and the loss of her mother in Missouri. We remember Becky Clay and the loss of her grandmother, Jim Schull and the loss of his first cousin in Houston, Texas. We remember Laurie Hall and Tim and their family and the death of Laurie's uncle. And we remember the family and friends of our former First Baptist music minister, Robert Sneed, in his passing this week. We know that Judy Burley continues to be in the hospital from our church family. There may be others, but we certainly pray for Judy as representative of those who are hospitalized from our church family. Now let's turn to the God of all the universe, who created the universe and placed into motion our lives in the love and care of His Son, Jesus Christ. Would you join me, please, in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, what a miraculous account that we have God's word fully revealed today. We see God was, God is, and God forever shall be. We pray for these who are hurting and lost. We pray for these who have lost a loved one, perhaps someone very, very close and dear to them. We pray for the Lord to be a great physician to these who are in need of healing. It may be a physical healing, or an emotional healing, or a spiritual healing. We pray for the person standing around nearby us right now. Perhaps one is in a special time of need or crisis, while another is rejoicing and thankful and cheerful. And for each, we bring to the throne of the Lord. We pray, God, that you would watch over those who serve in our military. As Shauna has already reminded us, these are days of concern and attacks. And so we pray for peace in our world. We pray for the men and women who serve in our military. Yes, certainly. We pray for the men and women who serve on our behalf in the mission field around the world, as far from north is to south and east is to west, representing us, yes, representing Jesus Christ. God, for we know that the only way for true peace is through Jesus Christ and trust and faith in Him. And so we also ask you now to receive the offerings that we'll be contributing. Lord, we reach down deeply and generously to support the work of Jesus Christ, and the mission and the ministry of Christ and this church. We pray that you will bless the giver and multiply these gifts to make a huge difference in our world today. And like the men and women of old, we bow before you with faith. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Thank you.
Good morning, church. Today we begin a new series of messages that deal with the whole subject of faith. And I hope this is going to be an encouragement to you. It's a great text. We're going to be exploring the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews for the next several weeks. And so I hope that you'll plan to be here every Sunday that you can this summer. This is where you're going to find God's people studying God's Word together. And so if you're away and can tune in just so you can kind of keep up with the series, I think it's going to be encouraging to you. This morning, we're going to begin with the very first three verses of the 11th chapter of the book of Hebrews. And then I'm going to read a related passage from the Old Testament, and I'll call your attention to that in just a few moments. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. It's a little different from your pew Bible today, but I believe with whatever device you're using or whatever Bible translation you have before you, that these words will be very, very similar. So I invite you to follow along as I read aloud. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. And now, if you would like to join me in Genesis chapter 1. And beginning with verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." And God made the expanse and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, "Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear." And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, "Let the earth sprout vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which their seed, each according to its kind on the earth." And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed according to their own kinds, and trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. God saw that it was good. There was evening and there was morning the third day. God said, "Let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the heavens to give light upon the earth." And it was so. And God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And God set them in the expanse of the heavens to give light on the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the expanse of the heavens. So God created the great sea creatures and every living creature that moves, with which the waters swarm according to their kind, and every winged bird according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. And God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the waters in the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures according to their kinds, livestock and creeping things, and beasts of the earth according to their kinds. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth according to their kinds, and the livestock according to their kinds, and everything that creeps on the ground according to its kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them. And God said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens and over every living thing that moves on the earth. God said, behold, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is on the face of the earth and every tree with seed in its fruit, and you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food, and it was so. And God saw everything that he made, and behold, it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. This is the word of God for the people of God. Today, as we begin this series, we're going to be talking about some definitions for the word faith. I hope this will be somewhat rudimentary, but I think it would also be helpful. The writer of the book of Hebrews gives us a very strong word that we can use for our definition as we begin. He says that faith is being sure and certain about unseen hopes and realities. This certainty, this assurance, this sense of the reality is caught up in the New Testament word that we find in verse 11. It's a word that is in some ways difficult to translate, and that's why if you were to lay out in front of you a number of different biblical translations of Hebrews chapter 11, 1, you would find all sorts of words trying to get to this idea. But the one thing that they have in common is that faith is a reality for the hopes and the things that are unseen. In other words, God's people, because of their faith, recognize that what we are hoping for and those things that are yet unseen are, in essence, a reality in front of us. I can explain that, perhaps, by taking you to the graveside or the funeral service that we would have for any number of our saints. I can take you there when I think about the assurance that I'm going to express in my life. I know that when this life is over, there's more to be had. I know that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I haven't seen heaven. I really don't necessarily put a lot of stock in those books and movies about people who've been there and have come back to tell us about it. You can do that. I'm going to stick with what the Bible says. There is appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. So if I'm wrong about that, let the Holy Spirit convict me and let God tell me later. I don't need you to line up after church and tell me about your various experiences, okay? Thank you. Here's the point. Heaven is real. How do I know it? Not because somebody's testimony came back and told me. I know it because God is trustworthy and God says it's going to be there. That's how I know it. So faith is that kind of assurance. It doesn't need extra biblical support. It needs God's word. When faith is convinced that what God has spoken is true, even if it is a hope, or even if it is something that is yet unseen, faith says you can count on this as your current reality. I think that's an important part of any definition for faith. Faith is being sure, and faith is being certain about those things that we hope for and those things that are yet unseen. Faith is living in accordance with this. It brings to us the sense that because this reality is real, then it's going to impact everything about the way we interact with people and in circumstances. When life gets tough and there are hard times that we face, faith says God's got this. When things are good and we're celebrating and we're thankful, we don't pat ourselves on the back and say that we put ourselves there. Faith says there is a God who loves me. There is a God of great design and intention. And isn't it great to be able to pause and worship this God of such infinite detail in my life? This interpretation is extremely important as we continue this study in weeks to come. We're going to see by faith Abraham, and by faith Moses, and by faith other heroes of the Old Testament stories just springing to life in front of us. It's important when we remember, for example, Abraham. By faith, because he saw the city whose builder and architect is God, he was able to persevere and to keep going in the direction where God was calling him. He went to places and he did things that could only be explained with this certainty that there is a God who's going to provide for him and provide the promises, the fulfillment of those promises that God has made. Hebrews chapter 11 summarizes these faith exploits of those who possessed a fame-worthy faith. And that's what we're calling this series. This is the fame-worthy faith series of this great roll call of the Old Testament faithful that we find in the book of Hebrews. By faith, they believed God's promises. They believed that they related to a state of affairs that was, as of their time, not seen, but that could be believed. They simply took God at His word, and by doing so, that directed their lives in a way that allowed them to live faithful lives for God. The English Standard Version Study Bible defines biblical faith as a confident trust in the eternal God, who is all-powerful, infinitely wise, and eternally trustworthy. I paraphrase that. Makes it a little bit easier for me to get it if no one else. It says that God can do anything, that God knows everything, and that life is better when we trust Him. That's what it means to have faith. It's to say that God is larger and more powerful and and bigger than we could have ever imagined. And that this God of the Bible can do anything, that he knows everything, and that life is going to be better when I trust him than when I try to do things on my own. Faith is a constant outlook of the trust that we have towards God, whereby human beings will say, all the things in life that I have, all the things that I am, the strengths, the personality, the education, all of those things are vital. They're important. They're significant. I'm thankful that I have them. But without God, they are nothing. I can forsake those things and I can trust him and things are going to be okay. One of the most basic level, or on the most basic level, we put our faith in God for one important reason, and that is that God is trustworthy. He has proven that over and over and over again. You read the Old Testament stories and you see that there is a God of trust, a God who promised to do certain things, and God's people said, we're going to trust you, and God never let them down. We know that without faith, it's impossible for us to please God. Hebrews 11, chapter 6, verse 6 tells us that. Now, faith is not a natural endowment that is necessarily embedded in our DNA of our soul. Rather, it's a supernatural gift from God. Faith is one of the characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit. It's a spiritual giftedness that God gives us. That's what faith is. Saving faith is a gift that God gives us so that we might be able to respond to the promises of the gospel. It is given to his children in measure with the express purpose of laying hold on that which is otherwise unattainable, which would be our salvation. Without faith, we're lost. With faith, we can move mountains. No matter what the life situation, whether it's a common situation to all of us, or whether it's something very unique that you find yourself facing, how we react is in reality a testimony to our faith. Our faith is either growing or our faith is diminishing, atrophying. The meaning of faith, according to Martin Luther's translation of Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, says that faith is the belief. It is a definite confidence in what one hopes for and does not doubt on the basis of what one does not see. In other words, faith is an unshakable confidence given by the Holy Spirit that God will actually do what God says and that he will do even what we ask. You want a stronger, better prayer life? Then build your faith. If we're gripped by a sense of reality, then doubt will not be possible. It will not be, we won't be swayed by outward circumstances. And while it's true that God, who is omnipresent, hears all prayers, those that are prayed by the most skillful prayer among us or those that are prayed by the novice, God hears all those prayers. And faith says that God has this sense, this reality that grips us, that says what we are asking for, we are in dialogue with the King of Kings, the great, great God revealed in Scripture. Now, notice one thing. By faith, Abraham. By faith, Moses. By faith, Isaac. And by faith, we read all those stories that are going to unfold in this 11th chapter. And if we're careless, we're going to skip the very first by faith. The very first by faith is found in that verse 3, chapter 11. It tells us that by faith, we believe that God created the universe, and that God created everything out of nothing. Now, this gets to be pretty personal for some people. Some who value education and insight that God has perhaps allowed them to experience over the years, or maybe it's an independence from God. They look at everything that is in our universe, and they'll lean towards any number of philosophies or theories. Some will choose evolution, for example, and say, well, I believe that maybe God sort of kicked the first domino over and evolution kind of took over from there, but God was behind it all. Isn't that the same thing? No, not really. And others might say, well, I believe that there's a God of intelligent design who kind of put things together, but then God took a big step back and everything has happened or has changed. There was a big bang and now we have this. And I just want to tell you, from my heart to yours, I believe it takes more faith to believe that than to believe that God is the maker of everything as described in the book of Genesis. In Genesis chapter 1, there's no question about it. It's a worship liturgy for the people of God. And there's no question about it that the book of Genesis is not a book of science. It's a book of theology. There's no question about that. I understand that. But sometimes, if we're not careful, we come to some points of human pride that begin to take over just a little bit. They can be suggested and they can be somehow embraced, and over the course of time we have found ourselves moving from a simple childlike faith and trust that God did exactly what the scripture says to any number of diluted ways of viewing creation. And here's the danger of that. Is that if we can incorporate any other things into that whole realm of creation, then it's just possible we'll also mix some things into some of the other aspects of faith that, quite frankly, are so important for us to affirm as biblical Christians. The ancient church. We look for just a moment to our spiritual ancestors, those that have gone long before us. And we don't recite it often in the Baptist church, but there's this core beliefs that is referred to as the Apostles' Creed. And in the Apostles' Creed, it begins with this affirmation, this declaration. Some of you know it. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Now, where did that come from? It's possible that the 11 original disciples and Matthias, who was added later, it's possible that those 12 disciples, before embarking on world mission, going to different places where they would never see each other again, it's possible that they held a meeting, almost like one of those upper room meetings, and said, well, what are the core beliefs? What are the things that are absolutely essential for us to agree on as we go out and preach this gospel message? There are some who believe that the Apostles' Creed came out of that Roman Creed where those apostles perhaps agreed together. Maybe one person wrote it. Maybe each of them contributed. We don't know. But historically, for 2,000 years now, Christians have been affirming their faith, and for much of that time, we've been doing so with words from this creed that is shared in churches all across the world on Sundays like today, where believers stand together and say, these are the things we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. Why is it important? Is it important? Well, again, let me talk to you just very personally. I don't know about you, but I need a God who is big enough and powerful enough to speak and bring into being everything from out of nothing. I need that kind of God. A God who does any less than that, I think is a God too small. A God who isn't able to stand under the scrutiny of science with the beauty of theology and see how they go hand in hand is a God that needs our defense, and I don't need a God that I need to defend. I need a God who is bigger than that. And so a God who can speak and out of nothing create everything there is the only kind of God that I need. I think he's the only kind of God you need. We need a God that powerful. We need a God who, when nothing else makes sense, can speak the word and it suddenly makes sense. And that word might simply be nothing more than, I am with you and I will not leave you. That's sufficient. Why are we going to study faith this summer? Why are we going to spend this much time walking through these great stories? Well, for one reason, faith anticipates the future. I need to be able to remind myself through the reading of God's Word and these wonderful stories that it contains, that faith says that the current circumstances are not all I am left with. Instead, faith promises a better future. It anticipates the future. Here's the second reason. We need to study faith this summer because faith helps us evaluate the present. People who are not people of faith are going to have a windfall of cash and they're not going to think twice about it. They're going to think it's theirs and they can do what they want to with it. People who are not people of faith are going to find sensual encounters randomly and think nothing about it because that's the way, you know, the body's designed. But people who are people of faith are going to recognize that the present is a reality where God is very much at work and where our response to what God is doing really matters. It has an eternal balance hanging with it. Third, we see that faith wins God's approval. Verse 2 of chapter 11 says that by faith, these spiritual ancestors of ours were commended. They had their right standing with God. We know that to be true as we read the stories of Abraham, whose righteousness was accredited to him by God because of his willingness to follow and take God at his word. We know that faith recognizes the very power of God. So today, when I read the words from Genesis chapter 1, they serve as a great reminder that God spoke and it was, that God said and it came to be, and that God evaluated it and God said it was very good. Friend, what do you do with where you are today in your journey? Well, one of the things that Peter says to the early church is that we see the very good things that God has in store for us and we work to add to them. And one of those things that we add is faith. I hope that as I emerge from this series a few weeks from now, I hope that my faith is stronger. I hope that your faith is stronger. I hope that when we sing, it's because we are people of faith who affirm what it is we believe. And I hope that you'll share with others, and I hope that you'll invite and encourage others to be a part of what happens on Sunday mornings when God's people worship together, because it is by faith that we progress on this journey. This morning, if you don't have a place that you call your church home, and one of the first things you need to do is to settle that issue of where God would have you and where God would have you serve and where God would have you grow and where God would have you under the authority of His preached word and where the gifts God has given you can be used to encourage others. One of the things that you might do today is simply recognize that God has led you to this place and you need to come and become a part of this church family. Maybe you've never put your faith and trust in Christ. And if that's the case, then today, I trust, I hope, I pray that as I have proclaimed God's words to you today, that you've sensed something stirring in your heart of hearts. And that can only be explained as a working of God's Spirit drawing you to salvation and convincing you of the truth of the gospel. Today, if that's the case, you come forward also. There'll be ministers standing down front, and we'd be so delighted to pray with you and encourage you. Joe's going to lead us in an invitation hymn. I'm going to invite you to stand and let us sing, and as you sing today, you respond in faith and you come as God has spoken to you. If you're a guest today, I hope that you'll give us the chance to greet you personally. I'll be standing in our foyer. We have a gift we'd like to give you. There'll be deacons and other ministers at every door. If we can encourage you or help you with anything at all today, if you have any questions, we'd be so honored to help you any way that we can. Let's remember that tomorrow night there will be no deacons meeting at First Baptist Church Monday night. There's another activity taking place next door. It's going to be a little busy downtown, so our deacons meeting is moved to Tuesday night this week. And then Wednesday night, there are no Wednesday night activities this week because of the CMA Fest. Nashville's an exciting place to be right now, but a lot of folks coming in town, and we want to give them plenty of room. So if you've not already been welcomed officially to Smashville, welcome. We're glad that you're here. Well, God bless you. Thanks for being here today. Joe's going to dismiss us in song. We look forward to seeing you.